thank you, Jacinta. Thank you also for inviting me into the Penticton Art Gallery for hosting such an amazing event. I've made it to a few of these before, but my work life often keeps me busy during the weekdays, so I can't often make it. So I feel honored to be among the great speakers that have already spoken here and the portfolio of people that are to come. Thanks, Lisa. Lisa's my friend here. She's just doing some recording so we can have this for future reference and work on the speech and presentation again. And thank you all for coming and sharing this time together. So you might wonder why I picked an outdoor photo when we were looking at a tiny home. The outdoor space becomes really important when you're living in a small space. So this is just basically the view right outside our kitchen window, and that's where, you know, outside in the backyard was when you can be quite expansive. and so wintertime obviously brings you more inside, but I just thought it was reflective of this time. And also I changed the title of the speech to Tiny Home Living, the Joys and Challenges of the Path to Simplicity, because as I started writing this speech, I started to move back and forward in time, like through my past, and a lot of reflection comes up when you start, especially investigating your own living spaces. So it was, you know, I started to look at the arduous days of university, the financial struggles of becoming a design entrepreneur, and now to this moment of ripening and finding clarity in what I'm doing and where I'm going. So I welcome you to this journey towards simplicity with me as we look at the joys and challenges of tiny home living. So tiny homes have been around for a long, long time, and they date back, as you can see, to the simplicity as well, back to the indigenous people around the world, the teepees, of course, from the Plains Tribe, Indians, including Blackfoot, Crow, Cheyenne, and Sioux, to name a few. This is an architecture that's so familiar to all of us here in North America. On the top right, where my father's from, is Australia, and that's a picture of... I don't know if it's the correct name from where that photo comes from, but in Western Australia they're called humpies, and they were made from things like, you know, the grasses, reeds, tree branches, and in this case porcupine grass. And down to the bottom right is where my mom is, you know, indicative of the architecture of the South Pacific. So my mom is from Western Samoa, and these buildings are called fales. And so the bigger buildings would be where the village people would get together for big ceremonies, whether it's weddings, funerals, exchanges of financial currency, like cultural currency, during like big celebrations. And then you'd see the smaller homes gathered around that, and that's where the people lived. And I still have family in Samoa today that still live like that. Basically, it's an open floor plan, and the storage will often be suitcases, like vintage suitcases that have, you know, each person's items of clothing in there, and they're all stacked up, and they just sleep on the floor. So there'll be the floor mats to cover the floor, and then there'll be like, now they have a bit more foam mattresses that are typical, and they roll out at nighttime, but during the day, the dining room is on the floor, you sit on the floor, you eat on the floor. They're really flexible in their hips, as opposed to us in the West, who are often used to sitting on chairs, with quite open body. So the idea of simplicity and tiny home living is something that's been in the human experience for a very long time. And looking at necessity, so also these homes were, you know, dealt with necessity. The items like food, shelter, clothing, and fuel, and fire in those days before there was the oil and gas, electricity. So this brings us to Henry David Thoreau, who, you know, you'll know from his writings and his philosophical writings and his poetry. This is his house called the Walden House, which he lived in for 2 years, in July 1845 to September 1847. It was located just out of Concord, Massachusetts. So he wrote a book called Walden, which is a narrative of his day-to-day life in this building. And he, as opposed to a lot of people that end up now living in tiny homes that have to do it by necessity because of the lack of ability to buy a bigger house or so on, he did this by choice. He had the opportunity to buy a bigger piece of land and chose to buy this small lot where he built this house to investigate, you know, how his ideas that capitalism is, you know, is decaying our humanity. It's a narrative of his day-to-day life that has become a blueprint to tiny house enthusiasts. So this book actually now feeds a lot of the people that are doing the tiny homes around a lot of North America, a lot in Europe, and it's become quite a Bible, I think. And basically, he speaks of the merits of living with less. He warned of the focus on materialism that corrodes the individual's humanity, creating a status quo dependent on luxuries and institutions. He advocated for independence, self-reliance, and simplicity of life. His experience of living in the Walden House with the necessities of food, shelter, clothing, and fuel enhanced the sense of living in the present. He lived with simplicity of possessions, actions, and economy. So, I mean, like I said, this whole process of writing this presentation has been a reflection back over my life, and I will talk about that a bit later, but there's an attachment that we have to things and to items, and I think living this way, when you're just limited to your experience, you actually become much more attached to the present. Like, you know, when without the ability for technology, say, or the allowance for us to just sit on our computers even, or light and phones and communication, he's there on his own, so he's engaging with the daylight as it comes. You know, it's time to go out and get the wood at this time, and then become, you know, you're living hour to hour, moment to moment, and much more engaged with nature, I believe. So he talked about economy and simplicity, and as I mentioned before, a lot of the people that choose to live in tiny homes now are doing so because of the current economy. It's becoming increasingly hard for the average working person to afford a home. And that was one thing he talked about, although he was in a financial situation, I believe, where he could have afforded more. So while Thoreau bought the Walden by a conscious choice, I've come to the path of simplicity out of necessity, or more clearly, out of relative poverty. I won't claim to know poverty in the sense that people in third world countries do, but as a university student that was sort of self-supporting, and then since then trying to run my own business without any capital to do so, I understand what it's like to live in this, you know, in Australia and in Canada without much at hand. The last decade has taught me how to live with limited finances. The tight budget of a university student and later that of a budding entrepreneur has seen me living in studio or one-bedroom apartments. I've learned how to make more with less. This interior shot of the Walden House is in many ways reflective of how I have lived for many years. Of course, I always had the walls full of art and prints and my university work and stuff, and then there'll be shoes tucked under the bed. You'll see the chaos when we get to our most recent house. And as I said, in contrast to Thoreau, I managed to jam-pack a whole ton of things into every tiny space I lived in. I did also live in a house with anywhere from 6 to 12 backpackers that were mostly from Europe. But in this house that was a four-bedroom house with people living in the living room at stages and sleeping outside in tents. We had a German girl living in a tent outside for a year, and there was also a Spanish girl that lived in a tent outside for 3 months. And they would sort of do things around the house in exchange for being able to camp in the backyard for free. So luckily it was Australia and they could manage to do that, but this place here is the carport that we eventually turned into an outdoor living space because we just really love living out there. I managed to get this kicking bag from a friend, and that's where I would train when I was doing my Muay Thai, and we spent a lot of time out there socializing, partying, visiting with friends. But this room, this is just one glimpse of it because it was actually a fairly big room. I had room for my bed and the sort of wardrobe area on this side of the screen, and on the other side of that screen is where I had room for the office and desk and a bit of floor space to do yoga. But where I really lived in that house was in my room. That's where I could just be me and retreat to the place of solitude and peace that was hard to get in a house full of partying Europeans. I also had a studio space in the many 6160 project in Fremantle, Western Australia. So this was an old department store that had been converted and turned over to artists and designers. And on the second floor where I was located was divided up into places for fashion designers, carpenters, furniture makers, printmakers, all of that. So I had the space in Fremantle for about a year. These photos are part of what looked like what part of it looked like when I first moved in. And this space was actually just one wall. I had another wall coming out this way, and maybe 100 square feet. And that space quickly got filled up. I ordered two workshop tables that were in there. Then I had two sofas that I found in an op shop. There were lamps. There were chairs that were being refinished. There was a fridge. You know, it doesn't take long to fill up space. So this was a year, like just as I moved into the space, and then year after that, I decided to come here to visit. I was supposed to come to Penticton for 3 months, and it's now been almost 4 years. So what happened was I left this stuff behind and the stuff from that other house behind. It was all packed into boxes because I was knew I was moving out of that, like wasn't returning to that house anymore when I came back, but it was all basically sitting in this studio space. So my poor sister had to deal with it and has been for the last 4 years, just shuffling it from one storage unit to another. So there one of the major challenges in relation to living in a tiny space is our attachment to things. And the ability to live without it. In my opinion, now that I've been looking at, you know, dealing with all this stuff, I even have stuff in Samoa, like all my childhood things. There's books, like there's a whole collection of Anne of Green Gables. There's, you know, what is it called? There's a new movie out with the time travel, A Wrinkle in Time. So I have all of those. I have all these amazing books, plus our encyclopedias that I refuse to let my father get rid of. But, you know, they're all sitting there. And these are things that sort of sit in the back of my head constantly going, when am I going to deal with this? It's this unfinished business. So, you know, there's a weight attached to having things scattered around the place. There's an energetic connection to these things. There is emotional attachment through the importance of memories. The importance, I kind of highlighted that, because, you know, the memories actually live in here and in our hearts. They don't necessarily live in those things, but we do connect to them a lot, to those items. There's a financial responsibility related to storage and potential shipping costs. Do I even remember these things? Does a leather handbag really mean that much to me? Because there's one bag I told my sister, no, don't throw it out. And I don't use it much because it's not very practical. It's really skinny like this, but, you know, I can't let her throw that out. As Anna C. Brackett said in 1836, we go on multiplying our conveniences only to multiply our cares. We increase our possessions only to the enlargement of our anxieties. So this is a photo of my room at my mom and dad's house in Red Wing, where I moved to when I left Australia. This is where I ended up living for almost a year when I came to Penticton for that three-month holiday. I had no possessions with me other than my clothes, a few meditation items, some books, and a small laptop. In the end, I didn't miss those items because what I was there for was, you know, the reason I didn't go back was because I needed to heal. There were a lot of things that, you know, that happened in your life, and it was just like, I actually need to be here. I need to be with my family. I don't need to be in a house full of 20 backpackers. And I just need time, you know, and space. And I never ended up putting anything on those walls. And this is what it actually looks like to this day. It's a spare room and there's nothing in there. And I found that kind of sparsity really reassuring because it allowed me to spend a lot of time in here and in my heart. It was in this room that I began to understand what was most important in my life, that being family, health, and inner peace. I began to reflect on the steps that had led me to this room, and in so doing, began to shape the values that would lay the foundation of the last 3 years of my life and where I am today. I do also like this quote by Dwayne Elgin. The intention of voluntary simplicity is not to dogmatically live with less. It's a more demanding intention of living with balance. This is a middle way that moves between the extremes of poverty and indulgence. And I think that's where I've been in the last, you know, decade or so, just sort of finding that way, you know, from feeling like you have nothing to feeling like you have everything. And I think now I've learned that you can feel like you have everything, even if you don't have much. So now the conversation can finally come to why you're here today, tiny home living. The presentation was initially going to be called The Challenges of Living in a Tiny Home, but I want to speak about the joys also, and in particular, as indicated by the introduction, The Path to Simplicity. I'll not give an overview on tiny homes or the current tiny home movement, nor will I provide you with templates, although I can. If you want to design a tiny space or something like that, I'd be happy to work with you on that. Here I will focus on my experience with my partner Peter Wolf at our home at 118 Bruce Court, Penticton. So we like to call this our accidental tiny home because when I met Peter, he was looking for a place to live. And I don't know if you know this address. Some of you do know Laurel Burnham. It's basically in her house. It's an attachment that they built at some point. And it is 300 square feet. I do have a floor plan to show you in a moment. And Peter was moving into that by himself, and I was very reluctant at any point to move in with him, but he convinced me to. And the first thing I did was you're now living with a designer, so this has got to change, because there was a double bed. I could not find the photos for the life of me when we first moved in, but there was a double bed in the living area on the ground, and then there was a futon right at the end of that that could fold down, which had no point being there because there's no way you could actually fold it down. There was some very, random storage items, and I think we've got the floor plan on the next screen. There we go. Can you see that okay from back there? Okay, so this is the front entrance. The driveway is right here, and Laurel and Daryl's house extends out this way, probably about that far. And you come in the front room. There's a bathroom here in the middle, and otherwise the whole space was open. I think that I drew the bathroom a little bit too narrow. It should probably come out to about there. There's windows here, so really nice corner windows, and then one window at the very back. This is north facing up towards Okanagan, and this is south facing down to Skaha Lake. Ideally, when you're designing homes, you want to have the openings in the northern hemisphere on the south side because you get the best quality of light throughout the day. But this worked really well for the afternoon light, and that side facing east got really nice morning light. So this is basically the floor plan as it is, as we left it, except we took this storage unit out. So I'm going to talk through the space from the entrance all the way to the back and how we gradually developed it over time. Yeah, so Peter had a bed here, and then there was a futon there. There was some random shelf kind of here, and there was a really ugly thing over the bathroom storage unit over top of the toilet. The kitchen cabinets and everything were here, and then there was one small kind of countertop that we extended eventually. So this is the chaos, what it looked like. This is the random shelf here that we had when we moved in. This part was existing, and we kept that to the very end. But as you can see, and as I mentioned before, when you live in a tiny house, it gets messy really, really quickly if you don't have storage. So storage is one of the fundamental things in living sanely in a tiny home. This is just... like, we're both creative people. Peter's a carpenter and I'm a designer, and I like to make macrame and 3D things, so there's just all this stuff that we had. This shelf we installed ourselves. That was one of the first things to go in, but it's just pretty chaotic. So this became the office space here, which is just in the kitchen, and then we had a little altar because meditation and yoga is really important to us. So we have our little altar with crystals and all the little hippie doohickeys that you'd have.
Can we just hold for a second?
Sure.
I'm wondering if these blinds come down will make it easier to see those.
Oh,
blinds.
Okay.
Can anybody reach that? Right there, I can't see anything.
Could you see the floor plan before okay?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
See that there? So, there's a whole collection of timber for Cougar and Wolf, because we've been working on that business for quite some time. We're just now refining it as we go along. But yeah, just there's sports equipment, all of these things that, we need. We really, really need them. A collection of art has started. So now we'll just start working on going through the building as we start to develop it. So I was working for myself with 557 Artist Block, so there was not an income there. We were sharing Peter's carpentry apprenticeship wage. And, ideally when you hire a designer, it's easy because you say what you want, you have money to pay them for design fees, you know how much it's going to cost to build it. But, being a designer in there, I have all that knowledge and I have a carpenter who's able to build it, but we also don't have the time and the space to build, and the finances behind it. So, because even if you're just getting the screws and the fixings, You know, there's still things that cost money, even if you're recycling timber. So it took, we lived there for 2 years, and it took most of that time to get this place up to what you see at the end. So as we go through the different areas, I've highlighted in blue so you can see the area that we worked on. So we decided to make a loftlet so we could increase the floor space and then turn that into a multi-purpose room, not just primarily a sleeping area. So it became a space for our bed, our office, yoga, exercise, entertainment, and a clothes rack of sorts.
So, sorry, what do you mean a loft? Oh, I see. Never mind.
Yeah.
That's my answer.
There it is. So that's the bed. There's enough room to sit up on top of it with about a foot and a half to spare. So that was Peter doing all the measurements. I like to do the big general planning of spaces, and then he works out the fine details of how thick is the mattress, because I get a little bit impatient with the details. So initially it ended up becoming our storage space. You see a bike underneath there. There's our suitcases with the seasonal clothes inside. There was a little table that had underneath it wood. There was a chop saw, like lots of tools. And then I made the clothing rack there just from a piece of metal that was hanging on a rope from underneath the framing of the bed. And then we had, I think there's a better photo later where you see a chair here, and that's how we used to get on top of the table. And this was a side table Peter built initially for something else, but he'd done it higher than, like, about the height of this plinth, a little bit shorter. So it's higher than a typical side table, but it turned out to be perfect for our bedside lamp, because all he'd have to do is lean over and switch it off. It was truly convenient. I'm just checking the time. I think we're okay. And this, you see this nice empty floor space here. It was about 4 meters square, so 8 square meters. I wish I could find the photo of a beautiful rug I got from Tees and Weaves, but that whole area, you know, eventually became very fundamental to Sing Living. So this is what it looks like when we took out all of the stuff underneath. We ended up getting a storage shed so that we could put a lot of the wood in and our seasonal equipment, the snowboards and skis and stuff like that. But my clothing rack still had nowhere to go, so it stayed there. And just to the left here, just slightly off screen, basically it was a timber chair, and we had some glue lam pieces on top of that, two pieces of like 2-inch glue lam, and then there was a block of timber that we used. So we used that to step up from a river rock, a huge river rock like this, on the floor, then we stepped onto that and then climbed onto the bed. So it was a lot of fun. So we constructed a suspended desk to hang. So Peter had found this really cool cable, steel cable, somewhere, probably the ReStore or something like that. And we took a leftover sheet of plywood that he'd got at a building site, and then designed a simple L-shaped desk to hang from under the bed, because we didn't want legs underneath, so that we could just have enough room to put more storage, because there's never enough space. And he just made a little ledger here to avoid the thing from flopping down at the back. There's a little hole there so the cable for the computer could go down behind it and into the wall. That's a view from another angle. And a couple more shots of that. So that's where we ended up putting the computer. So we got a big Mac screen, because then we could watch TV and movies on it through Netflix and the internet. So we just sit on the floor on this side of it and put cushions out on the floor, and that was our TV room. And the desk was always full of things, because we were supposed to construct a shelf that went down here for all of our, you know, artist pens and papers and everything, but we never got to it in the time that we were there. So this is essentially how it has been left. So this the living room is just, you know, closer to the entrance, so there's this extra room for living. So this is where I would do yoga and meditation. I even did Muay Thai, which you'll see in a second. And we did our art making here, and we watched the TVs and movies and games. And this, as I said, I drew this incorrectly. This should be wider, and that means the bed would take up about half of that space, and the rest was left for hanging out. So there's my kicking bag. And I had enough room to kick one side at a time, so I could stand at one part of the room and kick with my right leg without hitting something. And then when I needed to practice my other leg, I moved to the other side. And so I managed to do that. There was one night when Peter and I were being quite exuberant, and he punched it really hard, and it hit the window, but we didn't break it. I got a text message from Laurel, "That's enough." It felt like I was a teenager again. As you can see, the windows there, we frosted them out. So there's this film that you can get from Home Depot or something that it sticks to the windows, and it has a nice frosted cover. Because what the living room looks out to is the driveway on that side, and then the garbage on that side. So there was no reason for us. We had no view to look at. And we also needed privacy, and the curtains, like I wouldn't be opening and closing curtains. So this was a really good solution. This photo would have been taken at about 2 or 3 in the afternoon. So the light there in the afternoon was just beautiful. So in the morning, I would spend most of the morning until noon in the kitchen, and then I would shift to the living room in the afternoon. There's a peek of the little rug. There's my sheepskin for yoga. There's a little chair here and a side table. And then I had macrame place to work just here. Behind there, you could see the skis and the snowboards. So, yeah. Because it was winter, we brought them all back. So they needed to be in the house and not in the storage shed. In the bathroom, it was mostly about, like, it was fine. We just needed to beautify it a little bit, add some texture, and open the space with mirrors. And then reduce the storage to reduce my product collection, because if I have enough storage in a bathroom, I'll fill it with all kinds of colors of nail polish because of all the costume parties I need to go to that I'll never wear in real life. You know, I don't wear blue nail polish, but I need it for being a mermaid, you know. So I think the idea of having less storage in the bathroom was just trying to reduce the need for all of those things. And now I make my own face product, which Lisa's wife Liz sells for me like crazy. And it's one product that does a whole bunch of things. It treats my eczema, it moisturizes my hand, my face. So eventually I'm leading, you know, to a more minimal life and a bit more simplicity through out of this necessity. Unfortunately, I don't have too many photos of the bathroom, but this was, so previously there was a small mirror that just went right over the sink. And then there was a cabinet that was over top of the toilet. And it took up a lot of like space in there. So we were given this really large mirror from a friend. And we took that and laid it, you know, filled up the whole space with the mirror and moved the medicine cabinet back on the wall behind it. So then you had, that had mirror on it as well. And it just, you know, bounced the light around a bit more and gave the feeling of a bit more space. So Peter had brought this piece of driftwood back from Nelson, and I said, I think it would make a beautiful little counter for my supplies. So pretty much what you see there is all that I use for beauty supplies, the deodorant, the face exfoliants, all of that. And I haven't had the need to collect more, so I'll just borrow nail polish off people now. So the kitchen, obviously everybody has this the same in their own houses. It's a place for dining and socializing. But for us, it was also a place where we did games and we listened to music, and it was our studio space where we did artwork and we actually built in there, which you will see a bit later. So this part to the left is that original cabinet that was in one of the previous photos. We painted it white, and then Peter made a matching cabinet, which was set back, so we had enough room. Let me see. I don't know if you can see through. No, you can't really see. So that, you know, the door basically was where the back of the chairs would come to, or the edge of the door where the blue square is, and this shelf was just here. So we wanted to make it quite thin because, you know, you need enough space to get through. This building by no means is up to code for, like, universal access or fire in any way. Probably a lot of tiny homes aren't. But anyway, so this is set back, and it was initially going to be a storage space for his tools. But I was fighting that for a long time because I really think in order to be a proper design build team, we need a proper working space that is not in our home. And also tools are dirty, they're dusty. You know, and he'd have to build doors, and I don't know how much of that could actually fit in there. And it turns out he has a whole huge record collection in Montreal that he brought over and his mom brought over, so it became a beautiful place for our records as you can see, the record player sat on the countertop there. Our little collection of tiny art, because you can't have big paintings in a tiny house. Unfortunately, because Daddy had a piece, like, did you? She was like, oh, this is a great piece, you should have it, but there's nowhere for you to put it, so we missed out on that one. So here is Peter cooking. And as you can see, he's cooking on the kitchen table because there's really not any counter space behind him. You have a little bit of space next to the stove, and there's a stove, and then the space next to the sink, between the stove and the sink, is basically for your dishes. So we would just do all of our food prep on the kitchen table. We've had a pizza party in there with 8 people. And that was pizza, making pizza from the raw. So there were people sitting in the living room and like jammed in. Somebody's sitting on my exercise ball at the end of the table. And then our friend Austin's busy making the pizza. And there was like ingredients everywhere, like on the other counter space, all over the stove, and then just, you know, finding the place to roll out the pizza. It was fun. So you got to be really intimate and got to know your friends pretty well, and you come and socialize with us. And this is a workspace. I really like this one, Peter. He looks handsome, so anyway. So it doubled as a second office space. The light in here was always really good during the day. And Peter here is just planning another shelving system, not for our house, but another storage solution for somebody else. This photo was taken shortly after we moved in, but with before too long, it had a big, huge lamp on it, and that table, you know, it doesn't take long, like I said before, to fill up space. When we had guests, we'd often have two other people over. That was the ideal dinner party. It was just 2, maybe 3 people, and Peter and I would always sit on the right side, so we had easy access to the fridge, the stove, and the sink. Like I said, it's where we did our artwork. It's a photo of a print that I was making, and I think I didn't talk too much about it because it's not totally related, but being that it was a recycled timber table, you can do a lot of things when you have furniture that's made that's not precious, right? So sometimes the chisels would slip and go into the table. It was not a big deal at all. So that idea of innovation. The table also became the area where we analyzed and tested our designs. At the time of this photo, winter had set in and it was too cold to hang out on the deck. Aside from cutting these lengths of timber on the chop saw outside, the remainder of the work of this shelf system was done right inside on the kitchen table. We admired it so much that it ended up sitting on our dining table for 3 days. We actually even had dinner one day where we turned it a bit and Peter was eating on that part and my food plate was just here. And we were sort of talking to each other through the shelf, but I don't know, as creative people in this room or designers, you kind of sometimes get obsessed with something when it's good and you're happy with it, and we were really particularly happy with this system. So we didn't want to put it away and we had actually nowhere to put it anyway. And that's a view from the other side, and you could see the compactness of the space, because just right through there is our, you know, music area. So as you probably gathered by now, one of the most important things in a tiny home is storage space, you know, and how do you maximize the space? So often it is going up along the walls, which means that you don't have empty space and empty wall space for art. You need to have clear circulation space so you can move around, and it helps with the tidiness, which is really fundamental when you're trying to meditate in that space and do yoga. So this is another shot of the previous. I think I should have taken this slide up before, I'm sorry. So this is now the view of the loft bed's been done, and you can still see that my, you know, clothes rack is still there, but there's this big hideous thing that we, you know, inherited from my dad. He gave it to us, and we used it for the time, like it wobbled, so we had to put screws in the back of a piece of wood to stop from wobbling. And it was absolutely awful. We lived with it for about a year, but it did serve the purpose of like having somewhere for me to put my clothes. This one here was the first piece of storage that we built prior to the one in the kitchen, and it was a place for our books and some of our art supplies. So things had started to get tidier by this point, but obviously my clothing was a bit of an issue, and that is one thing that I have a hard time letting go of is clothes, because I love fashion. So anyway, we then designed. This is the space behind it, and you can see how much space is back there. We replicated the design of the bathroom mirror and put this just in the entry, so when you came in, it did again the same purpose of bouncing light around the room and opening up the space a little bit. And that empty space is where we designed what we call our hot box. So here's a drawing, the initial sketch of what we wanted that storage system to look like. And in you could see it behind there, it actually turned out pretty accurately. Mm-hmm. So that's how it ended up. I had two racks for my shirts and the short things, and a long hanging rack for dresses and coats and stuff. A little bit of room up the top. That little suitcase on the right is where some of my costumes live, and then some of the mattresses. Very at the very top are outdoor cushions from the lounge seats that we use to lie on and watch movies, and then some blankets. And then this was really important to me because I think in any entranceway you should have somewhere to sit, especially in the winter, to take your shoes off, put them on, or just to chat with people when they leave your house. So we made that little bench there where you could sit, you could check my makeup as I walked out the door, and also a really precious place for my shoes. Peter tried to fight me for that space, and I just took his shoes out and jammed it under there. I'm like, that's where your shoes can go because they're not fashion. So it's kind of mean, but he didn't fight me for too long on that. So we've mentioned this already. Our living space was our construction zone. So this is what it looked like just before we built the hallway shelf system. And these were, we didn't use all of this timber, but this was stuff Peter collected from his work job sites that was going to go to the dump otherwise. So we used a lot of this material at the sizes it was to build that hallway shelf. Oh, I don't know. That's an irrelevant photo. So outdoor living was, like I said in the original photo, it was really important for us. It's where you could go outside to breathe. And for us, it became a little garden. Our workshop, we dine and entertain out there. I would sit outside and read. And it was a shared space with Laurel and Daryl and her son and daughter-in-law. So there's Peter building out the back. It's quite an expansive backyard, beautiful selection of fruits throughout the summer and vegetables. And that's a photo taken right through the kitchen window. So I shut the window because all the sawdust was coming right inside the house. And in spite of shutting that, like by the end of the days of construction, there's just dust tracked all the way through, and I have to clean the house again. And yeah. And this is Peter, another photo of him creating this bench. So this bench we call Nice and Easy. We originally designed it for Little Long Studios. So you'll see the first one, the original one is there, and then the other one we made a replica of and kept it to ourselves because that piece of furniture to me is the epitome of simplicity in design. It was made from one really long length of timber that was cut, had three cuts, and then just assembled together and using the, not a cantilever kind of thing, but there's just two fixed screws that go underneath. Like there's not much fixings, it was not much as far as the time spent to work on it, but it's a beautiful, simple design and it works. You can dance on it, you can stand on the one end and it doesn't tip up. So that's our deck. I don't really have photos of when we finished working on that whole area, but Andrea and people that went to 557, you'll see the these little blocks that we used as chairs up in the gallery there, and they ended up being like displays for our plants and so on. And then this is just a photo of us sitting out there in that space. So, you know, in the summertime, we lived a lot on that deck. Like it was where we could go out. We just cook inside and then eat outside and just feel so like just to be out and feel the space all summer was really beautiful because after a time a tiny home does get on you, it gets on your nerves. So the feeling of space, luckily we live in a beautiful Okanagan and we can go out at any time of year and experience, you know, the expanses and the views and the spaciousness that nature has to offer. So we have a few off-site areas where we located things. We had a storage unit. It's an 8x10 storage unit, which has the whole side, left side. Peter built shelving for both sides, so the left side is full of timber. That is like potential projects. We've got one coming for Lisa and Liz. I also have some things left over. So I think they're at the Lear House that I need to collect at some point. But what doesn't fit and what can't be done here? You could say that you can't have parties, but we have had some amazing parties in there. They just, you know, spill out into the backyard, generally. This is a photo of us building something. Like, we couldn't have a table saw, obviously, in our place. So this is somebody's that we borrowed for the day to cut some major, like, long pieces that you can't do with the other tools without probably maiming yourself. And just a brief, you know, visit to tiny art, like the idea that you can't have big pieces of art in a small space. So we just collected things that were tiny, but we ended up collecting a lot of them. So there was really not much spare room in our space. That's, you know, that's a bit more of it. Yeah, so we collect a lot of things because we are like that. That is something that in this journey towards simplicity, I have a hard time. It's like, you know, I'm obsessed with beauty. I love it. And so, you know, you see something pretty or somebody gives you something. The creative community is very generous that way. They're always giving each other art and stuff. And, you know, so there's again that reattachment to things, once again, in spite of not having much room. So this is a photo of us as we move on, because I was offered to do this presentation before, in the fall, was it, Jacinta?
I think so.
Yeah, and at that time we had been sort of playing with the idea that we needed to expand and move out of this space, primarily because of our work. The actual living part is okay, but we really need somewhere where we can do our work, and generally a home studio is a bit easier because of the way we like to live, which is very much connected to home. So that's what the kitchen looked like on our last day when we packed up, a few cleaning cloths on there. But now the challenge is we move on to a bigger house. We're moving in tomorrow, actually, to a house on Caribou. It's got two bedrooms upstairs and two bedrooms down and a full suite downstairs. And what we've been really talking about over the last few months is that we want to not expand our belongings as we move into a bigger space, because we've learned a lot in this process. So how do you move into this space and just not fill it up immediately? So I think the challenge as I move boxes in tomorrow is maybe two boxes in and one box out. So hopefully I'll have a garage sale pretty soon and just get rid of the things and, you know, and still live with that, with the necessities and the things that are really, really important, and to keep dedicated to simplicity. I like this quote by Tenzin Palmo. One of the advantages of being born in an affluent society is that if one has any intelligence at all, one will realize that having more and more won't solve the problem. And happiness does not lie in possessions or even relationships. The answer lies within ourselves. If we can't find peace and happiness there, it's not going to come from the outside. So, you know, again, can we be dedicated to simplicity? How can we refine this discipline? Because it is, I think simplicity is actually a discipline. It's a choice. So this is another photo of the space when it's empty. Just Peter Parker, he's our spider pet, lives there, and, you know, so it's just at the very last day. And it was sort of really neat to see it, because when Peter moved in, it was filled pretty quickly, and we didn't really look at the space in the same way. We looked at it with potential, because you do it the same way you do a blank canvas. You're like, what can I fill it up with? So it was really interesting, knowing that I was doing this presentation, to look at it from the other perspective, going, wow, it's truly like it's a really pretty space for a massage studio for Rita. It would be perfect, you know, or like a little tiny yoga or an artist studio. Two people living in there, it was really, really full. Perfection is achieved not when there is nothing more to add, but when there is nothing left to take away. And that's often the problem in art making. So a lot of people just, I need to do a bit more. Then they do it. Often you can't take it away, and it was fine just as it was. So that's a challenge in our, you know, the challenge is how do we have a space for our creative practice and that feeling of potential and the love of beauty, you know, how does that all work together? We've not yet achieved this, we still collect. We collect pens, driftwood, rocks, shells, feathers, art, clothes, shoes, tools. So it's going to be quite a challenge. I'd be happy to be invited back in a year or two to see how we do in the bigger space. There's another shot of the kitchen and, you know, and looking back towards the front door. That front door you could never see, by the way. It was always covered with coats and bags. People couldn't often find the door handle to get out. Yeah. And as the architect Mies van der Rohe said, less is more. And he was a pretty iconic architect, and his buildings did reflect that philosophy. Oh. But I really like this one to end with. As Lao Tzu said, be content with what you have, rejoice in the way things are. When you realize there is nothing lacking, the whole world belongs to you. So if I can leave with you with anything, I hope that you find that in your own lives and in yourself, and I'd be happy to let you know how that journey is going for me in a year or so.
I believe Marlene has a few more minutes for questions. Anybody have any?
Did you have a shower?
Oh, yeah, we did, yeah. Yeah, there was a full bathtub, and that was a pretty special place, too, because, yeah. Yeah, bathing Epsom salt baths in the middle of winter, yeah. Yeah, and the shower was in there. So the bathroom was, you know, it was good. I've been in worse bathrooms that were just like, you know, they're not laid out well, or there's some weird, like, screens on the side of the toilet, and you're just kind of, yeah, I know we did. Yeah.
And you had a fridge in your kitchen?
Yes.
I saw the stove and the microwave.
Yeah, the fridge was just, like, I think this kind of space is ideal for, like, you know, an Airbnb or something like that.
Yeah.
Because, you know, a fridge that size, if it's temporary, is just fine, right?
Yeah.
You don't need to put in too much more than that.
Yeah,
yeah. And I think there's, like, I've seen also Europeans are so good at all of that technology. There's washer dryers for your clothes. Like, it's a washer and a spinner, but it's pretty much, like, that big. And you could pop it into your sink, and it just hooks up to your... to your you know, faucets, and then you could do your laundry in there. Of course, small loads, like, you'd probably have to take your laundry out to the laundromat. Speaking of laundry, we didn't have a laundry in here. We had to go out and use the house laundry, so yeah.
Are they gonna rent this out again?
Yeah, it's been rented since,
wow.
I think from the beginning of this month, because they were doing some painting, because we'd left a bunch of holes in there, and, you know, from all the artwork. But we didn't get in trouble because we'd actually built the loft bed, and the lady that moved into it, apparently she walked in and just fell in love with it, so, yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah,
great.
She had the bones.
How many boxes did you have when you moved out?
Oh, I meant to take a photo, because they're all in my mom's garage right now, but essentially, like, the amount of stuff we have is about, it's about like that, and piled up fairly high. So that includes the big closet we took with us too. And then, of course, that's not to mention the storage shed. But, you know, like, it's not a lot. Like, I know when we've moved out of my parents' house several times, there was a lot more stuff than that.
Mm-hmm.
But it still was like, every time I move, I just get anxious because there's so many things, and you're like, oh, I should get rid of this or give it to someone. And you're like, but yeah, but it's mine.
Yeah.
It's strange behavior, right? In a way, we're very used to that in the West, but then people like my family in Samoa, they don't have things, and then, like, you give them one small gift and they're just like overwhelmed by it, right? But we also have to work very hard for all of this stuff, which is something that they don't quite understand. They think it just comes to you. It's like, no, it doesn't really. Yeah.
I'm a bit familiar with your backyard.
Oh, are you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I officiated for Laurel and Derek when they got married.
Oh, right.
So I was wandering around in the backyard. They had a very unique wedding backyard.
Yeah, I can imagine.
You might say hello to them.
Okay, sure. And that, is that when they planted the peach tree too?
I don't recall exactly.
There's a little peach tree, and she's made this like rose vortex. It's like, I don't know if you remember the movie The Little Shop of Horrors and how the plants all just grow and take over.
I don't remember the details.
Yeah.
it was
in a very abundant garden, a really nice place to
change
to.
Yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. Well, hey, can you tell us a little bit about Cougar and Wolf design?
Oh, Cougar and Wolf design, yeah. So as mentioned, we make the upcycled furniture, I'll be working on my macrame, and Peter does a lot of artwork as well. I like doing things like functional art, so space dividers and things like that. But I've been working with Lisa. She's really good at brand development and helping us understand the vision of our business. So that's what we're focusing right on the immediate future, and fulfilling a few outstanding furniture orders that we have. But primarily it is about furniture, but we're also trying to align our vision with the values of simplicity, right? So, you know, what do we build? How efficiently can we make something? How practical is the design? How can we minimize the amount of materials for it? And then consulting with people on the design of their spaces. But we're doing that reluctantly. I think because also working with clients as far as design of space, there's that value system that you want to have working with the client as well. Like, you know, do you understand what we're about? Because if you don't, then maybe we're not the right people to work with. And I think, you know, your husband's an architect too. I think that really comes into play when you're working with design clients, that sometimes, you know, all of a sudden you can get into this thing where it's like, no, we're not seeing eye to eye. So that's a part where, like, I pulled back as a consultant, as a designer, because I just want to work for a while on my own vision and aesthetic and value system as far as design goes. And then when I have enough of a portfolio, I can say that with confidence to people that might need our services, going, okay, this is what we do. This is how we do it. This is why we do it. Are you okay with that? Does that align with who you are? So, yeah. And then we're having different divisions in there. So, As this journey to simplicity goes on, it also involves how there's a blog I've been reading, and it's called Becoming Minimalist, and his name is Jonathan. I can't quite remember. I'm happy to send the links through if anybody needs it later. But he talks about that minimalism and tiny home living is not just about like the material things. It's actually about doing less and being less. You know, just being less in the world, like, you know, the idea of taking time for yourself and saying no to more. So this is my year for saying no, because I've said yes for like many years, a lot of yeses, and it's fatiguing. It's beautiful for like the people receiving, I think, in a lot of ways, but at some point you go, wow, I'm kind of tired and I'm depleted. So I think simplicity comes back to that, the boundaries that you create for yourself and the limitations that you work within. So the tiny home can give you that idea of the physical limitations, but it can translate into the way you navigate through the world, you know? Just being able to say no and to know what really is necessary to you as a human being, and then working from that. Because it's so tempting to be like, yeah, I'll do that. Yes, I can be that. I'll be that for you. I'll be that for you. I'll do this. And it's this outward energy where I think if we all just take time to be with ourselves and that simplicity of just being, then those decisions could be a lot clearer and more expansive in the end. Because then the whole world is a blank canvas and you are abundantly rich.
So having done it and moved, and now you're moving,
yeah.
Would you live in 300 square feet again?
If there was a studio space for us to work, and that's what we kept trying to look for, but studio space in Penticton's hard. It's fairly hard to find, or it's really expensive. Yeah, so, you know, yeah. Like, I could, you know, we could renovate this house and rent it out and then go live in a tiny space and then have enough money to have a studio. But I think the biggest issue with us in living in the tiny home was being creative people that need a place to work that we didn't have. Because the actual living things don't take up too much space. But in you saw the amount of stuff in there. Like, if we were able to take up all of the artistic and creative stuff, then there would be a lot more room and it wouldn't feel so chaotic. Because pretty much as soon as we clean the house, you could clean the house in like an hour. Like, it would take, you know, if you're really fast at folding and organizing, it all goes away really quickly and it's beautiful. But then you cook your lunch meal after that and it's a disaster. Like, it feels like the whole place is a mess. So, you know, it's a good place for a short term or for one person that doesn't have a bunch of their work stuff or is like a collector of things. Yeah.
I had a space with my husband when we were both self-employed. And we were in about 330 square feet, which is pretty small for two people running a business.
It is, yeah.
But we had crawl space underneath, and we had an attic up above.
Right.
And so every time things happened, they went away,
yeah.
Right away.
Yeah.
And then a new project would come out, and you'd be working on it, and you'd make the big mess, and then it had to all go away.
Yeah.
So, but in the meantime, you could entertain in that space.
Exactly.
You know, there was enough room to do everything you needed to do,
yeah,
and still be able to function, and it worked just fine.
Yeah. Yeah, that's
but
so
you
true.
You need storage, all your stuff.
Exactly. Like a lot of the ancient Japanese houses and the tea rooms were like that. They're designed, you know, the room is nothing until you occupy it and do the action in it, you know, the activities. So it's an empty space and everything's stored behind the shoji screens. And then when it's time for bed, it becomes a bedroom because you pull out the things. But when it's time for tea, you pull out the whatever it's called,
yeah.
You know. I'm thinking of hibachi, but I'm not sure. It's just
yeah, it's all multifunctional.
Right.
And the
yeah.
outdoor space is so important.
Exactly.
It's a beautiful backyard.
Yeah.
And so, and we're in a more tropical climate, so the backyard was our living space.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
And it was very beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I'd recommend anybody to try it for you know a given time. I think what Walden was or Thoreau did was pretty impressive
yeah.
to like consciously choose that, right? And now that book is pretty fundamental for a lot of the tiny home movement people. So,
mm-hmm.
yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.